Hey, we're back with our architects, Uli and Eric, to go a little abstract this time. This time I'm going to answer the question, is that configurable? Join us. Welcome to the Azure Enablement Show, where we'll be discussing the challenges you and our other tech-savvy customers have encountered. Together, we'll be talking with experts to find out how they think about these problems, recommended tools and best practices, and tips they've learned from years of experience that you can use. So today on the Azure Enablement Show, we're doing something we've never done before. We're going to take our script, and we are going to simply rip it up, because we want to talk today about architecture. And architecture is a discussion. So we're back with Uli and Eric for some more architecture talk. This time I thought it might be kind of cool to go a little abstract and to kind of go deep into, you know, one of the architectural questions that I think that comes up all the time. And this comes up all the time, especially when architects are dealing with development teams. The question that I think we're gonna focus on here is the question of, is that configurable? So let's sort of just sort of frame this out a little bit in terms of what we mean by, is that configurable? So you're running software or you're deploying a system or something like that, and there's a choice to be made here. There's a choice to be made. There's lots of choices, I guess, is what this is all about, right? There's lots of choices about, you know, do you allow, do you provide for the opportunity to configure and to change the behavior of something? When do you allow it to do that? Do we hard code stuff? Do we not hard code stuff? Anyway, maybe one of you has a good place to start on this, because I find that there's so many different questions here. We can go in many directions, and we'll try to take as many as make sense.
So Uli, I hope you don't mind if I go first, because I'm coming from a place of pain around this, because I actually this topic came from my brain, and I wanted to kind of throw it out there. Is it configurable is a question that I find myself asking way too many developers across way too many code bases all the time, whether it's us internally or if it's us, you know, dealing with clients and customers. But there is this predilection to go fast and break things. But at the same time, we actually have to realize that we're accumulating technical debt. And so whether I'm doing a code review or I'm sensing the fact that somebody's taking a shortcut, asking this question is always key. And then the question becomes, well, what do we do if it's not configurable? Do we take time now to fix it? Or do we incur that technical debt and then come up with a strategy to reduce it later? But the questions that I often ask customers in this space is, why do you hard code? And maybe hard coding isn't always bad. Maybe there's a speed versus manageability trade-off that's made. But that's kind of like the background of why I thought this would be great for us to talk about.
I would throw another element into this. So this is obviously important, configuration and so forth. The other one that we also all know is that ultimately things need to change. And you can introduce change in a number of ways. You can rewrite code, or you can add new things and so forth. But configuration is another way where it can change the behavior of an application if you thought about it. And the third dimension of configuration in the larger sense is, what if there are situations that arise that you haven't thought about? How can you deal with that? And what are strategies for you to embrace that kind of new thinking, call it self-service in a lot of ways, that allows you to effectively build systems, solutions that can embrace and support those kind of flexibility choices that clients increasingly want to have, because they have very smart people that work in finance, in IT, in HR, whatever. And they might say, yeah, the workflow that Eric as the developer envisioned here is great, but it doesn't quite meet what I want to do. And so I don't want to go back to Eric and ask him to change the workflow. So I think there's a couple of interesting dimensions of configurability that we can talk about here.
So let's go into some of those dimensions. I want to also get a little less abstract here, but I also would like to play devil's advocate here a little bit for a moment, Eric, about the last thing you said. So your question about hard coding. Okay. Mm-hmm. So here's my argument for hard coding, which I don't necessarily believe, but I'm gonna submit it to you. If I hard code something, then I know exactly what is running in production. There's no guess. There's no guess as to what the parameters are. There's no guess as to what the new version of the retry timeout is. There's no guess on that sort of stuff. I just know what it is because it's right there in the code. I can point you to the source code. So what do you say to that?
I think that that is alluring, but I think it's a temptation that we have to start to move away from.
Okay.
Because there are systems that we can put in place that allow us to determine which branch of the code is actually running in which environment. And that, of course, focuses on everything from live site management to application deployment to source control systems and all of this stuff around how we manage code and the pipelines to deploy that code. A hard-coded, you know, maybe GUID that says, oh, this is in production, listen, that might be harmless, but coding ports and network addresses and all these different things inside the code that control functional behavior, that I don't think it, we have to resist that temptation. Now, on the other hand, though, David, you know, maybe playing devil's advocate to my own pet peeve, is that I've seen customers and some of our clients go in the opposite direction where everything is super configurable and they've got database tables and schemas and XML files and config files that the application has to just interpret at runtime. And that may actually slow it down and increase the surface for you to make configuration errors when you deploy. So it's a spectrum. And I think you want to be somewhere in here, like right in the middle.
So I want to ask what Uli thinks, but I just want to be clear. I'm not just talking about what version of the code do I have out there. I'm asking I'm talking about what I would call state, right? Which state is that collection of port numbers, that collection of retry timeout amounts. It is that collection of which database I'm using, you know, that configuration represents, right? An application, you know, it's a configuration and application state aren't the same thing because an application can diverge from its initial config, but we're still talking state here. And I'm saying like, if I give you the thing where the state is written in it, then I know what it is. Uli, what do you think about this? Like, do you think it's middle, like Eric's saying, or do you want to take even yet another contrary position to the three of us now?
Well, the way I think about it, I'm more on the extreme side, because ultimately, when you think about a development process, start with that scenario. You go from your developer test, user acceptance testing, or whatever you'd like to do, or if you're going cloud native, you're going to do A/B testing. You're doing deployment in rings and those kind of things. But at the end of the day, things change. And if you can't change with those things, I've seen the most funny errors. Unfortunately, they are very time consuming because somebody hard coded a dependency and all of a sudden you move from one environment to the other. Go back to some of the sessions we ran earlier when you do resiliency. Now, all of a sudden the cloud environment or the hosting environment you're running in decides that I need to eject you. I need to move you from this environment to another one. And all of a sudden the namespace changes, the IP addresses changes and whatnot. And all of a sudden you are dependent on what you learned where you originally ran and you can't do this anymore. So for me, dynamic behavior is implicit with configurability. And you be able to cope with dynamic behavior is really important. The way to deal with it though is when the application starts up, you effectively read the configuration once and you cache it. You don't go and check all the time. You might say there is a timer inside my application that says, if nothing happens, I will check every 24 hours or 48 hours, whatever it is, if something has changed. But I will not go continuously go read new stuff and so forth. So for me, you're looking at a balance between, yes, it needs to be dynamic and configurable, but on the other side, from the runtime perspective, try to keep it as static as possible.
So also make sure that you can forcibly expire a cache. So when you do have emergency changes, you can actually implement those and the app is just not ignoring you after you've changed values.
Okay, well, so let's follow this path for one moment because I suspect this is gonna be a multi-episode one as well. Where do you think changes in when do you think it's okay to change configuration? Let me be precise about that. Is it A, at deployment time? Is it B, at deployment time plus at runtime when perhaps you might throw some feature flag or something that says, okay, now start doing something different, add some behavior, pick another thing up? Is it C, all three of those? Or is it D, none of the above? I realize I'm doing A, B, C, D on figures, but
we have an ordinal number problem there. But yeah, exactly. I think these all have to be carefully couched in live site management and standard operating procedures and run books, whatever you want to call them. But deployment, sure, that should be an operational pipeline that deploys an application in a particular configuration, in a particular state, deterministically. When you're doing it live in production, it's either in a response to something dynamic, as Uli said, that has changed, whether or not it's a cloud migration and your host that you were running on now runs on a different host, and hopefully you shouldn't be able to tell the difference, but some instances you might, and you actually need to repair the state of that application. That should be executed under live site management operating procedures within full view of everybody. It should never be a developer logging into the VM or the, you know, redeploying something to a container to change the state willy-nilly. So I think it has to be carefully orchestrated, which leads me to your third choice, which was both of those, but under those circumstances.
The only piece I would like to add to Eric's point is configuration are software artifacts. They need to be managed like software artifacts.
Yeah.
So you need to look into whatever DevOps tool you use, and whatever method you use needs to include configuration and other metadata about your application. Again, I mentioned in one other session the concept of GitOps. That is one emerging capability that allows you to use Git to manage operational artifacts, which configuration ultimately is. In a repository and version it and understand which version is in production, what the difference between A and B was, so that you can really do understanding where did I, what part of my configuration drifted from A to B. So really treat those configuration items as if there were software artifacts.
Yep.
Okay, so I think that's a really good place to stop. I have more questions on this topic, but I think this is a good place to stop because it's like one of the most important things we can say, which is treat your config like code, right? Like in that way. And I think that's a fine place to stop. So why don't we stop here and then maybe we'll pick up this conversation or another conversation later.
Anytime.
Absolutely.
Okay, that was a really cool set of conversations. I hope you get a chance to watch those episodes. We're going to move on to another topic here on Armchair Architects as part of the Azure Enablement Show.